about yesterday. Okay, so let us continue. So what we have done yesterday was to prove the uniform energy estimates. So now it would seem that we are good to go to prove the compactness, but actually we will see that we need still one more estimate. But to tell you where this is going, so we want to prove the tightness of the laws of these approximate solutions. Yeah, and in particular, we are interested in what function spaces can we prove this tightness, or in other words, compactness in. So I define the following path space for the solutions. I call it calligraphic X of U. And this is the space L2 in time with values in our space H, intersected with continuous trajectories with values in some domain of the Stokes operator to the power minus beta 2. Yeah, and the parameter beta is to be determined. Actually, we are able to prove tightness for every beta strictly positive. But we will see that in a second. So this is for the solutions. And actually what I will do, I will not only prove tightness of these solutions, I mean of our approximate Galerkin solutions, but I will prove tightness of them together with the Brownian motion. Yeah. So actually I want to prove tightness of these joint laws. And for the solutions, they will take values in this function space. For the Brownian motion, I would also like to have some function space. So maybe you can remember what we did maybe a couple of days ago. So W was a cylindrical Wiener process, right? So there was this problem that the sum was only formal. It didn't converge in this space capital U. But we invented, or we introduced, the space capital U naught. Yeah? And we said it has continuous trajectories there. So this is the function space that I can use here. And this was actually the only reason I somehow told you about that space, yeah, because I needed that information, and we will use it here. Okay, so now I need some more notations, and then I will discuss the compactness. Okay, so I denote by mu un the law of un. I denote by mu w the law of w, and by mu n the joint law of the couple. And my goal is to prove tightness of this family of measures on the product space. So this is then a measure on let's say chi, which I denote as this product space. Okay, and let us start with the tightness of the solutions. Yeah, so what we should ask ourselves is whether our energy estimates are sufficient to prove really tightness in these spaces. Actually not, right? I think somebody was not very convinced. So our estimates are not yet sufficient. Yeah, so we remember we have a uniform bound in L infinity, 0 capital T with values in H. This was our one of the uniform bounds. And the other uniform bound that we have was L2, 0 capital T with values in V. Yeah, so this is already something, but that's not enough. Let us think for starters about this L2 with values in H. Yeah. Actually, what I need to do is I want to use a certain compact embedding. Yeah? So I want to find a function space where I have uniform estimates and which is compactly embedded into this space here. Now, why would this help? Well, if I had, okay, so I need some function space which is compactly embedded, so a compact embedding into L2, 0 capital T, with values in H. And so what compact embedding actually means is if I take a ball bounded set in this space, which we still have to figure out, it will be a compact set here. So this is how the compactness works, and this is what can then be used to prove the tightness. So actually what I want to have here is a space where I have my uniform estimate, so I can prove that I am in some sense in a bounded set, and this bounded set will be compact in this target space L2 with values in H. Okay, and so if we think now about this compactness, about this compact embedding, the idea is you always need some regularity, because regularity gives you compact embeddings. Yeah, so in principle, I need some space which is really better, which gives me more regularity than what is here. So in particular, I need some estimate or some function space here which would be compactly embedded into H. In other words, I would need to prove some spatial regularity. And now if we remember our estimates, well, we actually already have spatial regularity here. So that's already good. And this is one of the spaces that I want to have here. So this gives me more spatial regularity, but that's actually not enough. This embedding wouldn't be compact, so this would not be true. I need to add a space which would give me some time regularity as well. And with respect to the spatial variable, it can be much worse. So what I want to have here is so some time regularity, with values I need some parameter. So let me put here the power of the Stokes operator to minus gamma over 2, and now intersection of the two. Yeah, so roughly speaking, I need one space which is better in time, but I don't care whether it is worse in space, because you see the regularity here, it is even a negative Sobolev space. So this is, it has the time regularity with values in the space of distributions, which is of course worse than H, but it doesn't matter. Because I have this other space there, which, okay, it's not better in time, but it is better in space. Yeah. And so as a consequence, this embedding is compact. Okay, and so what that means for us now, we indeed need one more uniform estimate, which would give us such a time regularity. Yeah. Because this one we already have, so we still need to prove the time regularity. And this is what I want to discuss now. Typically, how one proves a time regularity is just by writing down the equation and estimating every term separately. So I want to prove a bound in this W alpha 2, 0, capital T, D, A minus gamma over 2. I didn't say what these parameters are. Yeah, actually, I mean, I need just some parameters. So for some alpha and gamma positive. Yeah. And you can already guess that since there is the stochastic integral in the equation, probably the time regularity will be limited. Right, so indeed, I can prove this bound for alpha between 0 and 1/2. But I want to stress that any alpha positive here will do. And actually, our gamma in the first step will be bigger than 3 over 2, I think. Okay, so this is now what we want to prove. And I said I write down the equation and estimate every term separately. So our Galerkin approximation was as follows. There was the projection of the initial condition. You see that I have already put all the terms on the right-hand side, because I want to prove some time regularity of this one, which is the same as proving the time regularity of everything on the right-hand side. Okay, so here I have my Stokes operator. Plus the convective term, which on the Galerkin level was given by P and B and U and U n. So that's the drift. And I should, of course, not forget my stochastic integral. And so that means I have now four terms on the right-hand side, and I denote them by J, sorry, J1n plus J4n. Yeah, at time t. Everything is at time t. Okay. Now, actually, you will see immediately that estimating the initial condition in this space is really straightforward. For the linear term, it's also straightforward. So I would like to focus on the convective term and on the stochastic integral. So first of all, let us think about the stochastic integral. So what I want to prove is that the stochastic integral belongs to this space. In particular, it has this time regularity. Since the operator G actually does not contain any derivatives, we will be able to prove a bound in a better space. Even I'm able to replace this distributional space by H. So we will see that in a second. But first of all, we need some estimate that allows us to prove time regularity of the stochastic integral. And so we haven't seen it before, so let me just write it down. So there is a lemma which tells you that for p bigger equal than 2, alpha in between 0, 1/2, there exists a universal constant which depends on these two parameters. Okay, let me just call it C positive. So it's uniformal in the sense it does not depend on the Brownian motion or on the integrand here. It's universal. Such that if I want to estimate my stochastic integral in expectation, and now I measure the norm that I'm interested in here. So this fractional Sobolev norm, phi dw, w alpha p, 0 capital T with values in H. If I have a stochastic integral which takes values in H, I want to measure its w alpha p time regularity. I can put the power p here as well. And this is what I would like to estimate. So this is really now a new estimate, and I want to estimate the stochastic integral somehow based on some bound for the integrand, of course. And so the bound that I have here is the expectation of the integral from 0 to capital T. Okay, and so now we can think about what would be here. Well, somehow we expect again the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So what I have here is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. Now the difference is it is taken to the power p dt. So if we compare to the Burgholder-Davis-Gande inequality or the Ito isometry, you remember there was only power 2. Even in the Burgholder-Davis-Gande inequality, there was power 2 here inside, and the rest of the power p over 2 was left outside of the time integral. So in other words, to prove Helder continuity, this fractional Sobolev regularity of the stochastic integral, we need more from our process phi, because I need now the Hilbert-Schmidt norm to be even in LP, yeah, where P can be generally bigger equal to 2. And actually, so in order to prove this estimate, since I put 2 here, I don't care about P bigger than 2. So for this bound, P equal to 2 would be sufficient. But we will see in a couple of minutes that for the Helder continuity, we need P bigger than 2. Yeah, so for the Helder continuity, which we do later, I will indeed use this estimate for some P bigger than 2. Yeah. And so really the punchline is, in order to prove that your stochastic integral is Helder continuous, you need somehow the Hilbert-Schmidt norm to be LP integrable for some P bigger than 2. So that means not every stochastic integral is Helder continuous, depends on the integrand. Okay. So if you wanna check out the proof of this result, it's actually not very difficult. You can take a look in the paper. Yeah, I mean, we mentioned it in the book. I'm not sure we prove it. Definitely Flandoli, Gatarek. So I think it's 95 stochastic Navier Stokes paper. So there it is definitely proved. I think maybe we did not prove it. Okay, and so now I would like to apply this bound to estimate the stochastic integral here. And as I'm hoping here to get W alpha 2, I apply this bound for P equal to 2. So in other words, I will estimate the expectation of my stochastic integral, which I here call J4. So J4n. And now the norm is in this space W alpha 2, 0 capital T, with values in H. To the power 2, yeah. So due to our assumptions, we will see that right now, due to our assumptions on this function g, we are able to be here even in a much better space than what appears here. Okay, so first of all, I use my estimate here. That means I get a constant, I get an expectation integral from 0 to capital T. And now I have my integrand from over there. So the projection g of u n, now the Hilbert-Schmidt norm from u to h to the power 2 dt. And I want to bound this uniformly in n. So at the moment, of course, we see n dependence on the right-hand side. But in principle, with this power 2, this is what we have already estimated yesterday. Yeah. So somehow, I would like to use the uniform energy estimates from yesterday, namely in these two spaces, to have a uniform bound for this one. Yeah, so again, the strategy is very similar to what we have seen several times yesterday. Well, there is still the projection, so I can forget the projection. Then I write down what is this Hilbert-Schmidt norm, and I use the linear growth assumption on my coefficients gk. Okay, so first of all, forgetting the projection and then writing down. What is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm? What I get is here integral from 0 to capital T, and here I have the sum norm gk un in h to the power 2 dt. Yeah, and now this is precisely a term that we have seen yesterday. So I use the linear growth assumption, meaning here this is bounded by some constant, which is the constant given by my coefficients gk. And we have seen already this is 1 plus un in the h norm to the power 2. Okay, so that's nice because what this boils down to is really something like a constant. There is the integer from 0 to t when I integrate 1 plus expectation integer from 0 to capital T un in the h norm to the power 2 dt. Yeah, now we remember that due to our energy estimates from yesterday, we have already a bound on this term. Also, eventually this is now bounded again by some constant that depends on capital T, on the coefficients G, maybe on some other parameters, but it does not depend on N. And I would have 1 plus, let's say again, the initial condition in the H norm to the power 2. Yeah, so this is now a uniform bound. We see that it does not depend on N. Yeah, so we see that uniformly in N, the stochastic integer has this fractional Sobolev time regularity. Okay. But we see that the stochastic integer actually does not require us to go to a space of distributions. Yeah, this is actually required by the convective term. So I would also like to show you how to do the estimation for the convective term. And for that, as a preparation, let me take the original operator BUU when it is applied to some test function V. And I want to estimate this. So first of all, let me just write down the definition and then we will see what estimate we can get. So it's the integral over the torus and the definition of the operator B is UC dot nabla. UC dot V dx. So this is just a definition of this operator. Yeah, and now, okay, now I can estimate. So we see that this function appears with a gradient. Yes. So the idea is I want to estimate this one in L2, this one in L2. And as a consequence, I am forced to estimate this one in L infinity, yeah, for the Helder inequality. Okay, so in other words, what I get here is V in L infinity. From here, I get U in L2. So this is always with respect to the spatial variable. And then I get gradient in L2. And, well, this can be estimated by U in the V norm. And actually, I can write here h. Okay. So this is good, and I remember that if let's say if delta is bigger than d over 2, then the domain of A to delta over 2 is embedded into L infinity. Yeah, which means I can bound this L infinity norm by the norm here. So this gives me some constant. This constant comes only from this embedding here. So it does not depend on my functions V and U. And here I put, and the norm in this space is just given by this in the L2, and L2 is h. And then I'm still left with u and v, u in the v norm. Okay, and so what we deduce from here is if I plug in there a function u which actually lives in v, I can estimate my operator BUU in the space of distributions, namely dA2 minus delta over 2, yeah, which is the dual space to this one. And the bound is just given by, yeah, there is some constant, which is actually this constant here. So u in the H norm, u in the V norm. Okay, and so this is the reason why somehow this negative space here appears, and actually gamma is my delta here. Yeah, so with this preparation, I would like to conclude. I would like to prove that the term, this one, J3, is bounded in this space, or actually it will be even in a better space. So maybe now you can take a minute to think about it, yeah, how to prove that time regularity. So to deduce the time regularity that I want from here, as the next step, I estimate now really what appears in the time integral in this term J3. So there was Bn, Bn, Un, Un, and I want to control this in L2 with respect to time, and now in the domain of the negative Stokes operator to the power minus delta over 2. And I take the whole thing to the power 2 for simplicity. And I aim at using my previous estimate from over there. Now, so what does this mean? Well, first of all, I have the L2 in time, so I just write down what that is. So that's the integral from 0 to capital T, and now we have the projection Bn, Un, Un. Now I have this norm minus delta over 2 to the power 2 dt. Okay. So first of all, exactly as before, by the definition of the projection, I can forget the projection. Yeah, then in my definition of Bn, there is still the cutoff, but I could also forget the cutoff. So eventually, I can estimate this by the integral from 0 to capital T, B, Un, Un in this norm, minus delta over 2. The power 2 dt. Yeah, and this is now good because I can apply my estimate that we derived here. Yeah, and also the good point is that u comes once in h and once in v. And I'm hoping to use my energy estimates which I, yeah, those from yesterday. But it, there is still the time integral, so we have to make sure that really everything works. But first of all, I use that estimate from the very right blackboard. There is some constant, so this means smaller equal than some constant. I get the time integral, and then I have un in the h norm to the power 2, un in the v norm to the power 2 dt. Okay, now if we think about the energy estimates from yesterday. So the v norm can be only controlled with respect to time in L2, or from 0 to capital T. So here I cannot do much, it has to stay inside this time integral. Yeah? But the point is that for the h norm we had L infinity in time. So that's nice because I can take it out. So this is just smaller equal than the supremum over t, and now un to the power 2 in the h norm, and this remains. Un in the v norm to the power 2 dt. Yeah, and so this looks good, and you see somehow I would like to use both energy estimates from yesterday. But there is, of course, still something missing. I need expectation, and I need them to be separated. I can only estimate this one in expectation and this one in expectation separately. Yeah. So this is what can be estimated, and we still need to get there. Okay, and so this is what we can do. Maybe directly now. So I take expectation of my term J3. Now I don't take it to the power 2, only to the power 1. And here I want to take the following Sobolev norm. So W12 with respect to time with values in this space, domain of A to minus delta over 2. So this is what I want to estimate. And you remember the term J3 was time integral of what I have written here. In other words, this is its time derivative. And that's why, so we can control, hopefully, its derivative in L2, and that's the reason why I go for W12 here. Okay, and so I use my previous estimate. And we should observe that here I don't have any square, whereas here there was a square. So that means I get, yeah, that this is smaller equal to some constant expectation, and there would be square root now. Supremum over time, now the un in the h norm to the power 2, and the time integral from 0 to capital T, un in the v norm to the power 2 dt. Yeah, and now you see that this is already good because we have this square root here which helps us. Yeah, because by using Young inequality we would be able to separate these two, so this to separate the product into a sum of two squares, and each of them can be controlled in expectation. So that's the bound from yesterday. Yeah, so just by Young inequality, I get some constant, and there will be expectation now of the supremum over time, un in the h norm to the power 2. So that's one, and the other one is the expectation of the time integral from 0 to capital T, un in the v norm to the power 2 dt. Yes. And I should end this bracket. Yeah, and that's good because these are precisely the estimates or the norms that we estimated yesterday. So we know already that this is now smaller equal than some constant, 1 plus expectation of the initial condition in the H norm to the power 2. Yeah, so this way we are able to derive time regularity of the convective term. So the regularity is much bigger than what we get, the time regularity is much bigger than what we get for the stochastic integral. You see here we get even one derivative in L2, whereas for the stochastic integral, yeah, I don't have it here anymore, the time regularity is of course limited by the time regularity of the Brownian motion. So there I could only get to 1/2, strictly smaller than 1/2. Yeah, so on the one hand, the stochastic integral has a worse estimate with respect to the time regularity. On the other hand, it has a better estimate with respect to the spatial regularity here. Yeah. And so now the idea is I take the worst space out of these two. So I can in particular use the embedding W alpha 2 0 capital T d a to minus delta over 2. So this is the space I'm aiming for, and So for the stochastic integral, we have a bound in W alpha 2, 0 capital T with values in H. And we know that this is embedded into the space W alpha 2, 0 capital T with domains in this space of distributions. Now, so this is what I use for the stochastic integral. And for the convective term, I have a bound in W 1, 2, 0 capital T with values in this d of a minus delta over 2. And this is embedded into W alpha 2, 0 capital T d a to minus delta over 2. Yeah, so that means for both terms, I prove a bound in this space. Yeah, and you can then check later that for the term J1, that was just the initial condition actually, and J2, that was the term with the Stokes operator, I also am able to prove bounds in this space. So as a consequence, what I can derive from this, looking at my Galerkin approximation, is that every term on the right-hand side belongs to this space uniformly in N. So I can deduce actually even more than that, because I have a bound uniform in expectation. I can deduce that un in this space W alpha 2 0 capital T with values in this domain. Now I take it only to the power 1. Certainly I cannot have a bigger power because this one has only power 1. The stochastic integral has the power 2, but okay, I cannot really use it because the convective term is worse. Yeah, so from this I estimate now every term on the right hand side of my Galerkin approximation, and I deduce that this is now smaller equal to some constant 1 plus the initial condition in the H norm to the power 2. Okay, so finally we were able to obtain this missing time regularity estimate. Yeah, so our Galerkin approximations belong also uniformly with respect to N to this fractional Sobolev space. And finally, this allows us to conclude the tightness in the space L2 with values in H. So this is what we are going to discuss now. Yeah, so maybe what you can think about now is how to actually prove this tightness. So I suggested we want to use the compact embedding, but the question is, how do we use that? How does that computation actually go? Okay, so for the tightness in L2 with values in H, I said we want to use this compact embedding, but maybe before we get there, maybe let us recall also the definition of the tightness to be sure that we know what we are really proving. Yeah, so I want to prove that, in the first step, I want to prove that the family of laws mu u n, as n is a natural number, is tight family of probability measures on this space L2 with values in H. And so what does this mean? I have to prove that for every given epsilon, which is positive, there exists a compact set, which is a subset of L2, 0 capital T with values in H. It is a compact set. And the point is that it is uniformly large. It has a uniformly large probability, which I can write as follows. So mu u n applied to the set K is, it should be large, so bigger equal than 1 minus epsilon, for every n. So the point is, this is somehow what puts all these measures mu u n together. For a given epsilon, we look for a compact set that of course depends on epsilon, so that all these measures give this compact set a large number. So this is what we are trying to prove. And based on the compact embedding, it somehow boils down to looking for uniformly large bounded sets in the space where we have the uniform bounds. So the compact embedding that we want to use, so by the compact embedding that we want to use here, so that was this W alpha 2 0 capital T D A minus delta over 2 intersected with L2 0 capital T with values in V, and this is now compactly embedded into my space L2 0 capital T with values in H. And so we said that bounded sets here are compact there. So that's the tool that we are gonna use. We are looking for a bounded set in this topology which is somehow uniformly large. Okay, and so to this end, let me define just a ball in this function space on the left-hand side. So it will be a ball of radius R. So that means I take all functions U in this space, so W alpha 2 0 capital T with values in dA to minus delta over 2 intersected with L2 0 capital T with values in V. And it should be a ball of radius R. So here we have a metric on this space. It is given by the sum of the two norms. So What I want here is that the sum of the two norms is smaller or equal to r. So in that sense, it would be a ball of radius r. So here the norm w alpha 2, 0 capital T with values in dA minus delta over 2, plus the norm in the other space, which is L2, 0 capital T with values in V, and it should be smaller or equal to r. Yeah, so now this is a ball. It is a closed ball in the topology on the left-hand side. By the compact embedding, it is a compact set in the topology on the right-hand side. Okay, so we have to prove that whenever somebody gives me an epsilon, I can choose r sufficiently large so that this property is satisfied for k being my set BR. So that's the idea. And now how can we prove it? So in other words, I want that mu un of BR is bigger equal than 1 minus epsilon. So alternatively, mu un of the complement of the set is smaller equal to epsilon. So this is actually more practical for this computation. So I take a complement of my set BR. Yeah. Okay, so what can we do now? We should realize what is this complement. So the BR means the sum of the two norms is smaller or equal than R. Yeah, now the complement means it is not true, and therefore at least one of them is bigger or equal to R over 2. Yeah, or even bigger, strictly bigger than R over 2. And therefore I can estimate this by, and I also use the definition of what this probability measure is. So it is the law of the solution un, it is the push-forward measure, and just by definition of a push-forward measure, this means that the probability that un in the first norm, w alpha 2 with values in dA minus delta over 2, so the first one is strictly bigger than r over 2, so either the first one or the other one, and I could immediately separate them and so estimate this by separate probabilities. So the other one is now un, L2 with values in V is bigger than R over 2. Yeah, and so now we need a tool which tells us that choosing R large enough, I could bound the right-hand side here by epsilon. Yeah, so for a given epsilon, I want to choose R sufficiently large so that this is smaller than epsilon. So how can this be done? Maybe somebody has an idea? Yeah, exactly. So I want to use the Chebyshev inequality. And what it gives me is the following. So the Chebyshev inequality gives me a bound 2 over R. And now I will have expectation of this norm plus expectation of that norm. So expectation of un to the norm in W alpha 2 dA minus delta over 2 plus expectation of the other norm un in the L2 with values in V. Okay, and now you see this is good because for the first one that's precisely the estimate that we have proved earlier today. Yeah, and also this power 1 is sufficient there. So this is good. The first expectation is bounded uniformly in N, and this second one of course as well. Yeah, I even have a better estimate for this. I can even put 2 here. That means the norm is in L2 with respect to omega, therefore it is also in L1 with respect to omega. Yeah, so in other words, what I get here is some constant which depends on the initial condition and capital T, etc., over R. Yeah, and the important point is, of course, that this constant does not depend on N. Yeah, now you see that I can choose R large enough so that this is smaller than epsilon for every given epsilon. Yeah. So indeed, we have proved the tightness of these measures mu, u, n on this space L2H. Okay, so that's good, but this is not all. Because for me, this space L2H is not enough. I would like to have also tightness on the space of continuous functions. I need some space of continuous functions, for instance, to pass to the limit in the equation. One could also use it to prove then progressive measurability of the limit. Yeah, and here it doesn't matter to me that I get some negative Sobolev space here, so some space of distributions. That's not a problem. Yeah, but we should still discuss how to apply a similar approach with some compact embedding to get tightness on this space. So we need for that also some compact embedding. Okay, so what can we do here? So how can we prove compactness in a space of continuous functions? What do we need for that? Arcella-Ascoli, yes. Yeah, so this is the Arcella-Ascoli theorem. So that means what I would like to apply is, let's say, a compact embedding where I get some alpha here, so Helder continuity, and here okay, this will be compactly embedded into the space of continuous functions dA minus beta over 2. So what I need is compactness of embedding of this space into that, which boils down to what? Gamma smaller than beta. Okay. So in other words, we don't have to worry much about this space because we can just vary this parameter beta and change it, and we will get a compact embedding. What we have to worry about is the Helder continuity. And because you see, what we did so far was W alpha 2, and this is not embedded into Helder functions. So in particular, due to the stochastic integral, so far we don't know if it is uniformly Helder continuous. On the other hand, for the convective term, we have W12, which is embedded into Helder continuous functions. Yeah, because here I have much more regularity than for the stochastic integral. So actually, this estimate is already good. Yeah, and the same will be true for the estimates of these other two terms. So we have to worry about the stochastic integral. So what can we modify? Somehow we would like to increase alpha, but that's actually not possible. Sorry? Gamma is less than beta? I hope is the correct direction. somehow the point is that this space has to be better, which means less negative, so gamma should be smaller. Yeah, so for the embedding into Helder functions, it's like I would like to increase the time regularity here, but we know that that's not possible for the stochastic integral. So it's really limited here by 1/2. Yeah. And actually that alpha, yeah, could be different from this alpha. But what I can increase is the integrability. Yeah, and the point that this also helps me, because there is a compact embedding, yeah, or even not compact. So if I take W alpha, let me do alpha prime here, because this is enough for any alpha prime bigger than zero. So if I do W alpha p with respect to time and values, let's say h, this is now compactly, this is now embedded into continuous function. So not compactly, for the compact embedding I would then use this one. Into, yeah, so this will be embedded into some Helder functions also with values in H, provided alpha times p strictly bigger than 1. Yeah, so that's basically the Sobolev embedding. So for depending on how much bigger than 1 it is, I can increase the alpha prime here. But as I said, for me in the end, any alpha prime positive will do. And so now if you think about the regularity of the stochastic integral, the alpha here is limited by 1/2. That means if I take p equal to 2, as I did here, it does not work. I don't get the Helder continuous functions. But the hope is that I can actually increase the power p, make it sufficiently large, so that I am embedded into Helder functions. Yeah, and for that, you remember this time regularity lemma for the stochastic integral that I mentioned, we can now apply it with general P. So I need to get a new estimate for my stochastic integral now. So that was J4 of n. And now I want to estimate W alpha p norm with values in h to the power p. Yeah, so this is now well prepared for that estimate that I mentioned. And how did it go? So this was smaller equal than some universal constant expectation of the time integral from 0 to capital T, and now we had the Hilbert-Schmidt norm to the power p, and our stochastic integral is png of u n Hilbert-Schmidt norm from u to h now to the power p dt. Yeah, so this will be now our final estimate, and we have to make sure that this is again bounded uniformly in n. Yeah, and well, it's not very much different from the case when we did it with p equal to. So I really do exactly the same. I forget the projection, I write down what is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, I use the linear growth assumption, and we are happy. Yeah, so a constant expectation. So first I forget the projection, then I write down the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, gk u n h to the power 2, and the whole Hilbert-Schmidt norm exactly should be to the power p over 2. Yeah, so the Hilbert-Schmidt norm is everything without this power p here. And it was to the power p, that's why I added here. And I have dt. Yeah, and now we already know. So this is really, again, the same estimate. I use my linear growth assumption, estimate this by a constant expectation. And here, so what would be there? So from here, I get again my constant 1 plus un in the h norm to the power 2. And then I can put the p over 2 inside by changing the constant, but that doesn't matter. So what I get here, integral from 0 to capital T, 1 plus un to the in the h norm to the power p dt. Yeah, and you see again, I can integrate here, put the expectation and the time integral over to the un to the power p. So let me write that down. There's again some constant which depends on capital T and p, and the coefficients g. And now 1 plus expectation of the time integral, and now un in the h norm to the power p dt. Yeah, and you remember when we started thinking about the uniform energy estimates, I told you I need to add this power p, which is bigger than 2, only in the stochastic setting. This was not necessary in the deterministic setting, or there you kind of get it for free. And this is the reason why I needed that. Yeah, so this is the reason why our function, when we applied the Itô formula, was u in the h norm to the power p for some p. I actually need it here. I need it for some p strictly bigger than 2. Yeah, so p equal to 2 was not enough. And this is the reason. So this is the reason, but as a consequence of applying Itô formula to this norm to the power p, the energy estimate that we obtained yesterday had indeed the norm of h here to the power p. So this was more equal than a constant uniformly in n. Yeah, and this is really the reason, and this is the point where I use it. So now we know that this is smaller equal, again, than some constant, 1 plus the initial condition in the h norm to the power p. Okay, so what we have achieved now is we estimated the stochastic integral even in a better space. And now this space is already embedded into the Helder continuous functions, and therefore I can use this compact embedding. The estimates of the deterministic terms, they were always somehow in this W12 with values somewhere, and this is already embedded into Helder continuous functions. So I will end up with this compact embedding, and my solutions can be shown to be uniformly bounded in expectation in this space, and therefore really exactly by the same approach as what we did here. So with such a ball of some radius r, I can again really do the same computation and Chebyshev inequality. Then I would end up with my expectation that I can bound uniformly in n, and again I will choose r sufficiently large so that the whole thing is small. So I will not repeat, but you see that the important ingredient is really this compact embedding here and the fact that we have bounds in this space. So that's nice, and this concludes the proof of tightness of these measures mu, u, n. But you remember I wanted to have tightness not only of the laws of solutions, but also I wanted to include the Brownian motion there. So we should now discuss how to do that.
So Martina, what is the
Yes, so you say alpha p is 1 plus epsilon, so then I get alpha prime equal epsilon, you say? Yeah, so for that we should think about what values of p can we allow here. And, well, that only depends on the integrability of the initial condition. So actually, I think I told you the initial condition is not random, so the expectation is not there. And I mean, this is really just a finite number. If the initial condition belongs to H and is not random, okay, for any p finite, this estimate is good. Okay, okay. So is the question... Yeah, okay, I don't know. Maybe... Yeah, so that's from the Sobolev embedding. Yeah, okay. But the point is that I can make alpha as close to 1/2 as I want, and I could send p kind of to infinity. So I guess here I would get also any alpha prime smaller than 1/2. Yeah. Yes, yeah, exactly. So I use it very much. I think there are some works by Martin Ondrejat, maybe Zislav Trezniak, on Navier Stokes, on the whole space. I don't know what they do there. I would need to check. We can discuss later. Okay, but that's a very good point. So, for instance, I used always these compact embeddings, let's say V compactly embedded into H. And this is true on a bounded domain. It's not true on the full space. Yeah, so you remember my domain was the torus, which is bounded. You can use other bounded domains with other boundary conditions, but you cannot use the full space because you use this compact embedding. Okay, so that's a very good point. Maybe some other questions? Yeah, and yeah, you would need some uniform estimates for that. Yeah, I think what you suggest can be down for the positive Sobolev spaces, but for the negative ones, I don't know. Yeah, but anyway, I could then take a look at this paper, see what they do there. Yeah. Okay, so what we have proved is tightness of these measures mu, u, n on the corresponding path space. Now the question is about the tightness of the law of a Brownian motion. Yeah, you remember actually our Galerkin solutions, they all had the same Brownian motion. So here the Brownian motion actually does not depend on n. So we are in a nice situation that actually they all have the same law, because it's just the law of a Brownian motion. Yeah, so actually I would like to say that this measure, it's just one measure in this family, that it is also tight. And there is a simple argument that says so. So mu w is tight since it is a Borel probability measure on a separable metric space. So it's tight as it is a Borel probability measure on a Polish space. So, and since we have only one measure here, because we have just, we have just one Brownian motion, this is enough. Actually, I also told you that it can happen, and it will happen for the compressible Navier Stokes system, where I wouldn't be able to get some approximations, all of them with the same Brownian motion. So that means in that situation, I would also have n here. Yeah. But each of them is a Brownian motion. And I mean, Brownian motion is uniquely determined by its law, and there is just one law of a Brownian motion. Meaning, even if we are in this situation, the law, let's say, of mu wn is just the law of a Brownian motion. It's just really one measure. Yeah. Therefore, the tightness, even in that setting, just follows from this sentence here. But okay, that's not what we have. We don't have to worry about it now anyway. Okay, so now we know that this one is tight. I mean, family of those measures is tight. Family of those measures is tight. And still, we need one little argument, because you remember, I want to prove tightness of these measures mu n, which was the law given by the vector. So u n and w, so the joint law. And so now I want to use the information from here and the information from there to deduce that also this family of measures is tight. And if you recall the definition of tightness, okay, so this is on our path space X, which was XU times XW. And if you recall the definition of tightness, that means I'm for a given epsilon, I am looking for a compact set here in this product space. And the compact set should be somehow uniformly large. And if you think about it, we already have tightness of the of one projection here and tightness of the other projection there. That means for a given epsilon, there is a compact here, which is somehow uniformly large with respect to laws of these guys. And there is a compact here, which is also uniformly large. So that means, let me write it down. For every epsilon which is given to me, there exists, let's say, Ku, which is compact in chi of u, so that mu u n, so this is the projection on the first component of this ku, is bigger equal than 1 minus epsilon over 2. So this is the tightness for these measures. And exactly the same way, I use the tightness of the law of the Brownian motion. So there is a kw compact in xw, so that mu w k of w is bigger or equal than 1 minus epsilon over 2. Yeah, and now this is nice because I'm looking for a compact set in this product space, so you can guess what compact set I should take. So I just take K to be the product. K of U, product, K of W. Yeah, and now product of compact sets is a compact set in the product topology, and this is really the compact I was looking for. Yeah, and this allows me, you can then do the computation. There is still a little bit of arguments, so one should use the De Morgan somehow, De Morgan's laws. So to prove that this is really a good compact for me, which allows me to prove tightness of these measures mu n, mu n. Yeah, so I will leave this computation to you. And we still have a little bit of time, so let me, So let me continue. So we have proven the tightness of these probability measures. And so now we are good in the situation where we can apply the Skorohod representation theorem. Okay. So the family of mu n tight is tight on a Polish space. There are different versions of this Skorohod representation theorem, but here we are in a separable metric space, so this is the nice, this is the classical version of this theorem. We will have to worry about more general versions later for the compressible Navier Stokes. Okay, so this is what we proved, and the Skorohod representation theorem tells me that there exists a new probability space with random variables u tilde n, w tilde n on this new probability space, and there are also some limiting guys u tilde, w tilde. Now the first property links these random variables to the original ones. Yeah, namely the, maybe actually this notation is easier. So the law of u tilde n, w tilde n is the same as the law of u and w. So these random variables are defined on the new probability space. These are on the old one, so these are our Galerkin approximations. And here I mean that they have the same law, the same push-forward measure. And the last property is the one that we wanted the most, namely, that's the convergence. So u n w tilde n converges to u tilde w tilde in the topology of my space calligraphic X, p tilde almost surely. Okay, so you see that even though on the original probability space we had only one Brownian motion, now I really have a sequence of Brownian motions. Yeah, it's not true that I can then say here I have only one Brownian motion. So I have a priori a sequence of Brownian motions. Okay, and so now we would like to use this to eventually conclude that this limiting random variable solves the Navier-Stokes system on this probability space. Yeah, okay, and so how to do that? Well, we proceed in several steps. First of all, what I want to show is that these approximations solve the Galerkin approximation on this new space. So there is this will be the first step, un w tilde n solves my Galerkin approximation. Yeah, Yeah, so in particular, this also involves proving that W tilde n is a cylindrical Wiener process. So I have to find an argument why this one is also a cylindrical Wiener process and why the couple solves my Galerkin approximation. Okay, so this is the first step. The second step is I want to identify the limit, so I want to pass to the limit. And since I have the Galerkin approximation on the new probability space, I really just need to pass to the limit in every term. Okay, so that's easy to say. It's easy to say, but what can we use? So we have the convergence here. We have again all the uniform estimates that we had on the previous, on the original probability space. They carry over to the new probability space. Yeah, and this is already enough to pass to the limit in the deterministic part of the equation. And what we should discuss is the passage to the limit in the stochastic integral. Yeah, and for that we have a convergence lemma. I think, yeah. So in particular, I need to prove that again, W tilde is a cylindrical Wiener process. Yeah, so for that, I also need a little argument to prove that. And I need to pass to the limit in the stochastic integral. So I need to prove that Pn of g, now un tilde, dwn tilde, because this is what appears in my Galerkin approximation on the new probability space. And I want to prove that this guy converges to what I want to have there, gu tilde dw tilde, yeah, in a suitable space. So this is what I need to prove, and once I have that, I'm done. Yeah. So I think maybe the best is I would invite you to take a look at the book, so I hope that everybody has an access to it. Bright Fireisel Hofmanova. You can take a look at, I think it's chapter 2. You can review everything that we did here. So in chapter 2, what you find there is somehow an introduction to these stochastic analysis tools. So there you find more things that would be needed for the Navier Stokes, and those maybe you can skip in the first reading, but you could review what we discussed here. And in particular, you will find really results that allow you to do all this. So you can look for them and you can really think about how to justify every step that we still need to justify. So in a sense, well, there are several possibilities how to identify the limit as a solution, and one of them is really to use results that are here and kind of apply them as a black box. So there are theorems, you have to collect them and then see, okay, I apply this theorem to get that, apply this theorem to get that, etc. And if you wish, you can also take a look at the proofs. And I think I will then still discuss these points on Monday morning. And I thank you very much.